और गुड
अरुण, लेट अस स्टार्ट द
इवनिंग
प्रोग्राम।
मेंबर्स, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ नेल्लूर ब्रांच एंड ओंगोल ब्रांच ऑफ एसआईआरसी ऑफ आईसीआई, आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस वीसीएम ऑन स्टैंडर्ड्स एंड ऑडिटिंग एंड यूडीआईएन। आई वेलकम नेल्लूर ब्रांच चेयरमैन सीए सुजीत कुमार जैन एंड ओंगोल ब्रांच चेयरमैन सीए के राजेंद्र प्रसाद सर टू दिस वीसीएम। आई ऑल्सो वेलकम टूडेज चीफ गेस्ट सीए टी चिन्नमसन सर, वाइस चेयरमैन ऑफ एसआईआरसी ऑफ आईसीआई टू दिस वीसीएम। I welcome today's faculty, CA Thottapalli Vijay Kumar sir, for this VCM. Before we proceed, I request all of us to stand for the ICI motto song.
Yaesha Supteshu Jagrati Yaesha Supteshu Jagrati कामं 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 कामशो पुरुषो निर्मिमाणः निर्मिमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद्ब्रह्मा तद्ब्रह्मा तदेवामृतमुच्यते तस्मिन् लोकः शतः
Thank you, sir. Now I request Nellore branch chairman CA Sujit Kumar Jain to give his opening remarks.
Aruna, I have sent you the agenda. First address is by our Ongole branch here.
Okay, sir. I request Ongole branch chairman CA K Rajendra Prasad sir to give his opening remarks.
Good evening, all of you. Respected today's chief guest, vice chairman of SAIRS of ICI. ఎక్స్ ఆఫీషియో ఆఫ్ ఒంగోలు అండ్ నెల్లూరు బ్రాంచెస్ సిఏ టి చిన్నమస్తాన్ గారు, నెల్లూరు బ్రాంచ్ చైర్మన్ సిఏ సుజిత్ జైన్ గారు హోస్ట్ బ్రాంచ్, అండ్ టుడేస్ రిసోర్స్ పర్సన్ సిఏ టి విజయ్ గారు, అండ్ సీనియర్ మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ ది ప్రొఫెషన్ అండ్ మై డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్ అండ్ కోలీగ్స్. ఆన్ బిహాఫ్ ఆఫ్ ఒంగోలు అండ్ నెల్లూరు బ్రాంచ్ ఆఫ్ ఎస్ఐఆర్స్ ఆఫ్ ఐసిఐ, వీ వెల్కమ్ యూ ఆల్ ఫర్ ది టుడేస్ సిపిఈ సెమినార్ ఆన్ Standards on auditing and UDIN. This standards on auditing is very, very important for all of us, and nowadays UDIN has become mandatory for our certifications. We have learned so many auditing standards during our education period while passing CA, but this standards on auditing and accounting standards are both are very, very important for the proper discharge of our functions. So our Nellore branch has chosen this wonderful subject which we learned long back, and it is going to be a very good refresher for us. Our today's chief guest CA T. Chennamasthan garu is our ex officio member and known to each and every one of us. He is very close to all our members, and during the last period his support is quite good for both the branches. We used to call him throughout the day, any time, at any point of time. We used to get lot of suggestions from him. With lot of smile and caring, he used to attend all our calls. I think many of our members have also called Chinnamasthan garu for several issues. He is very update on MEF and bank audit panels, and we thank him for coming for this. We congratulate him coming for this CPE seminar as a chief guest. CA Thottapalli Vijay garu is a senior chartered accountant and authoritative on this subject. I hope he is going to refresh and rebrush us on this auditing standards and UDIN. So members have a lot of doubts on UDIN. See, in the past 3 years we have faced several issues with UDIN. Now the UDIN portal is stabilized. I think he is going to clarify all our doubts in UDIN, I request Thottapalli Vijay Garu to have a question answer session on UDIN. I also thank Sujit Kumar Garu for taking initiation in conducting a joint program. We have already conducted several joint programs. He voluntarily came and associated with Ongole branch. Thank you, sir. Thank you for offering this joint forum for us. Now all our videos, I think both Nellore and Ongole videos are uploaded on YouTube channel. All the members are requested to subscribe to the respective YouTube channels. And if you have any issues related to the registration or attendance, you can contact the respective branches. I thank one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I request Nellore branch chairman, C.A. Sujit Kumar Jain, to speak on this occasion.
Good evening, members. I thank our chief guest, C.A. P. Chinnamasthan, sir, for accepting our invitation and attending for this program. I also thank the faculty, C.A. Thottapalli Vijay Garu, for accepting our invitation for taking today's seminar. And further, I would like to thank the Ongole branch chairman, C.A. K. Rajan Prasad Garu, for accepting our idea to host a joint seminar so that the members of both the branches can get the maximum benefit of today's session, that is standards on auditing and UDIN. Basically, the standards on auditing is like a Bible to us chartered accountants, and it protects us from the scrutiny by the various stakeholders. Basically, our financial statements are relied by a wide variety of stakeholders like bankers, these shareholders of the companies, and various other institutions, the governmental agencies and everything. So if we can follow the standards on auditing meticulously, this will save our skin and even will enhance the reputation of our individual name and as well as the mother name of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So we thought there is a need for us to go back to these standards on auditing and rebrush our skills and understand them in a wide variety of manner, and particularly with respect to the size of practice we have. So that was the request made to the faculty to have the seminar with the perspective of small and medium chartered accountants who are based at Nellore and Ongole. So I think that today's session will go a long way in making us in understanding the standards on auditing. And further, UDIN, even though it has come and is in existence for almost 3 years, there is a lot of doubts with regards to for which kind of documents UDIN is necessary and for which kind of documents UDIN is not necessary. So I think many of those doubts will be asked and get clarified today. And even the ever-ending doubt on this financial state, provisional financial statements projections, which is already addressed by Ongole branch, even some light can be thrown on that. With this, I would like to take leave. And thank you for giving me this opportunity. Over to Arun.
Thank you, sir. Now I request today's chief guest, C.A. T. Chinnamasthan, sir, to address the gathering.
Yes. My greetings to Chairman of Nellore Branch, C.A. Sujit Kumar Jain, and Chairman of Ongole Branch, C.A. Rajan Prasad Garu, and Secretary of Nellore Branch, Arun, and Past Chairman, Unsi Krishna, Jayan Mohan Garu, Satyanarayan Garu, and Vijay Kumar, and office bearers of both the branches, and FC members, and Past Chairman of both the branch, my dear members, who joined for this virtual CP meeting on standard of audit and UDIN guidelines. Very good evening to everyone. My special thanks to my big brother. I always speak as a Anaya, and the today's speaker, Thottapalli Vijay Garu, who has readily accepted and requested to talk on standards on auditing and UDIN guidelines. Members, though the standard on audit is not a new one for our see a paternity, but always it is a better and suggest to refresh our knowledge on the known subject so that we will be in touch with the recent updates on the professional front. And one of the important and the right measure proactively taken by ICAI to protect our members from fake, I can say fake accountants who presented themselves as a chartered accountants, especially in the MUPSIL areas, is that UDIN. I believe everyone attending here meticulously following the guidelines issued by the ICAI from time to time with this regard to UDIN. I have very confident and I have the experience on the Thottapalli Vijay sir from today's program would touch upon the critical issues involved in the UDIN and the other relevant updates on the auditing standards, which would help our members in updating themselves and to sign the updated reports. Coming to the general address members, we know that this is the year, is the election year. The election code will be start from the 1st September onwards and by the maybe in the January end 2022 of next year. So this is the online program, maybe the last program to participate in the Nellore branch. I request the members, our institute has hosted the draft list of voters. You can find that the name of your details, whether it comes under the poll or postal. Our institute has made that different locations based on the district where the members having more than 25 or more within a jurisdiction of the 50 kilometers, they mentioned as a polling center. If not within the 25 members and not within the 50 kilometers, there they announced as a postal ballots. So this is the information I want to share the members. But one initiatives for the election point of view, the concept of anywhere voting. Maybe guidelines will be announced by the institute in the due course. This concept will definitely get the high voting from the across the pan India basis. Suppose if any member having address at Nellore, working at Chennai or Bangalore, earlier concept he has to come to the Nellore and to cast the vote. That is the only option. Now the institute will give the option to vote from the Chennai or Bangalore, even though having the professional address at Nellore. But the respective members need to opt the and intimate to our institute at least 15 days prior to the election date. The election date will be on 3rd and the 4th of the December 21. So this is the election point of view. And members, regarding this MEF, the recently our PDC committee has announced the MEF application for 21-22 will be hosted by first week of October or the end of the September because of the various guidelines need to be complied by the MEF applications. So this interaction and negotiation is going on the RBI. Once they get the clarity, the application will be hosted. That's already institute has announced. So with this, my best wishes to everyone. All the best to each one of you. Jai Hind, Jai Shri. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Now I request CA Jagan Mohan sir, Ongole branch member, to introduce the faculty to us.
Voice is very low, Arun. Can I start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, members of Ongole branch and Nellore branch. I have a great privilege to introduce today's resource person, CA Thottapalli Vijay of Hyderabad. He is a 44th rank holder in ICAI intermediate examination in the year 1987. He got rich experience in post qualification, that is more than 30 years experience he got, and out of which he worked in top big four, PwC, EY and Deloitte, nearly 17 plus years. And he got very good exposure in IndAS, Indian IndGAAP and IFRS and UK GAAP. Worked on statutory audits of listed companies, IndAS implementation of large PSUs, internal control on financial reporting validations, limited review of listed companies, internal audits, IT general control reviews, migration testing, business process control reviews, income tax representation and filings, GST compliances and GST audits. Worked as a member of the senior management team of PwC India outsourcing project. Worked with Smart Stats team in PwC, UK and in India. Exposure to range of sectors, namely manufacturing, metals and minerals, trading, technology, banking and retail. Good communication skills. Regular speaker on IndAS, internal controls on financial reporting, documentation, GST, bank audits and other related subjects including UDIN and peer review of ICAI. He has already spoken several branches as for our members like Guntur, Vijayawada, Nellore, Hyderabad, Karimnagar and Warangal, etc. He is also in Institute of Public Enterprises, Hyderabad and Institute of Cost Accountants of India, Vijayawada and Hyderabad branches, Institute of Directors, Hyderabad and Usmani University, Hyderabad, trained new recruits in C&AG in IndAS. He has given several meetings in these institutions. Regular contributor to exposure drafts issued by ICAI, qualified independent director membership number so-and-so, lifetime member of independent director as per Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. He is also a co-opted member of IndAS IFRS Implementation Committee of ICAI for the year 2016 and 17. Now co-opted member of Auditing and Assurance Standards Board of ICAI for the year 21-22. Co-opted member of Companies Law Committee in Federation of Telangana Chambers of Commerce. Convener of Company Law Audit and Auditing Standards Study Group at ICAI Hyderabad. With this brief background, I am presenting Mr. Thottapalli Vijay to the August gathering. Thank you very much.
Sir, before going, one question I got with the permission of Vijay Kumar. Vijay sir, one question I got from participants, I want to give the answer. The question is that post-qualification courses and certification courses, they are trying to pay the fee in online, but the system is not accepting. Members, the problem is that every certification course and post-qualification course is the maximum is the 50 only limit. Once that limit 50 is registration over, then automatically payment will be suspended by institute itself. So that is the only one reason that payment is not accepting. Generally, if any course announced by the institute, first they will send the mail to the members. It generally reaches to the spam, not the inbox. So when we can find that learning.ica.org, then by itself it's a 50 registration is over. If anybody wants specific any courses, please let me know that. I'll try to help and you will get the seat. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for clarifying our member doubt.
Thank you, Vijayan.
Thank you.
Please, Thottapalli Vijay sir, to continue with the session.
Good evening. I hope I am audible now.
Yes, sir. And the screen is also visible, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Chairman Sujit Garu of Nellore branch, and Chairman Ongole Branch and all the management committee members of Nellore and Ongole Branch, and my friend and brother Chinnamarthan for giving me this opportunity to speak to the members of Nellore Branch and Ongole Branch. I think I'm talking to the Nellore Branch for the third time, I think. Barring last year, I used to visit almost every year, with some topic or the other. I know some people in Nellore in person, and I thank them all for, giving me this opportunity to speak to you on standards of auditing, which is an ignored subject for many of the younger chartered accountants. And people think these standards are only applicable to a large corporate bank, and they don't bother for small and medium organizations. But let me update you, it is something like a refresher for all of you. Except for SCA 700 onwards, which are applicable to corporates, rest of all the standards are applicable to any assurance engagement which you do. So kindly please bear with me on that, and all the auditing standards are applicable to all organizations or enterprises except SA 700 and all. So please be very clear on that. And today we are going to run through a brief introduction of what is an audit and things like that, and an overview of all the accounting, all the auditing standards. Plus, for small and medium enterprises, I want to cover what was the basic minimum documentation that is required on the file, which will be in line with the auditing standards. So that will be very helpful. And I want to also share with you the Institute publication on documentation for small and medium entities. So probably that will help you to enhance your audit programs and other documentation requirements in the file, so that you will be well equipped with peer review or any other external reviews or during bad times. Documentation, if you make it in your files, which will support you to face any kind of reviews. With this, let me refresh you in terms of saying what is an audit, why an audit. See, generally you all know there is misstatement arise from fraud or error are considered material if individually or aggregate, that they could reasonably be expected to influence the economic decisions of the users of financial statements. So this particular jargon is nothing but simplify for any financial statement, because the business is measured not in barter system, it is measured in rupee and rupee equivalent. So while you compile all those transactions that are incurred during a particular period, which is called a financial year, that is it, that could be for 12 months or beyond, depending on the approvals which you get from the respective regulators. So these financial statements, our duty is to ensure that they are free from fraud or error, which is not material. That means each financial statement has to determine whether a particular error or fraud which is material, and this material financial material, if there has been an error, then the financial statement is termed to be materially misstated. So having said that, so we need to ensure as an auditor that the financial statements are free from material misstatements to fraud or error. And I just want to share you a small joke. Generally we have this kind of bearing in mind when you find certain issues to share with the clients. We have to think when we should tell him about the discrepancies what we have found, because the client is a monster. So we are at the receiving end, or I mean off lead. You know, we have a fear that we may lose him, or the regulators are going to nail us for any eventuality, or we, or the client is not going to listen because of his fear size. As we are aware that, you know, these smaller entities make a substantial contribution in the Indian economy, and quantitatively, and the majority of audits are also of small entities. I am not touching down those audits where accounting and auditing are done by the same firm. So I don't want to end up in that controversy. I consider accounting aspect is done by an independent agency, and the auditing is done by auditing firms. So with that background only, I am talking this entire presentation. And you all know in India, in those entities in corporate sector get their accounts auditing, and even in non-corporate sector also, there is a mandatory auditing requirement for certain laws and regulations like tax audit and so on and so forth. So all mandatory company, then that gives us that for all these kind of an audit, the standards of auditing, irrespective of the nature, size, and complexity of the entity, are applicable because they are mandatory. SCAs, unlike accounting standards, need to accommodate audits of large and most complex multinationals, and at the same level, small entities also. I am stressing this point quite often because people who are performing the assurance function or the auditing function thinks the auditing standards are only for large entities, not for small and medium entities. It is an anomaly, mistake, or ignorance. Kindly note in a big bolded letters that the auditing standards issued by the institute, which are called SAs, are applicable to all the assurance engagement, which includes even your certifications which you issue. Let us look at what are all the objectives of the audit, whether it is big or small. The objective of an audit remains the same. Our objective is to obtain reasonable assurance whether the consolidated financial statement as a whole or the standalone financial statements, which are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error. So, and we make this kind of a statement in the audit report. To look at the SCA 700 illustrative audit report, even for corporate and non-corporate entities, we give this sentence in the auditor's responsibility paragraph. We generally write it and we don't bother what it is, because it has been given in the standard as an illustrative audit report. We tend to copy it and put it. We are not little bothered about this. But now the regulators are reading our report and coming back to us. Okay, since you are saying this, where are that documentation? How do you expect that you have enough comfort on the financial statements that you are giving your opinion? So that is where is the catch is. So we need to refresh our auditing skills within the framework of the standards laid down by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So you all know misstatement can arise either from fraud or by error, and which are what we are supposed to consider only those mistakes or errors which are material in nature. Material in nature could be relating to an aggregate of transactions or an individual transaction per se. And there is a specific standard on materiality, how to compute materiality, and so on and so forth. I will also show you in the subsequent presentation in terms of a particular template on calculation of the materiality. Okay. I hope I am clear. I mean, please park your doubts, then you know we will address it either in between when we take a break or at the end of the session, depending on the on our time availability and the permission of chairman and the other senior management committee members. Okay, let us look at what is an audit. An audit is, as we said, a reasonable assurance of expression of opinion of an entity where an auditor does an independent examination of the financial information. So, you as an auditor, there are financial statements given to you, financial information, and you are not supposed to prepare it. You are only supposed to repair it, or you know, even in repairing, you are not supposed to pass entries or make adjustments. You have to only suggest the client saying, these are all the errors. If there is any possibility, they can repair those financial statements, because once they are repaired or if they are not repairable, then you have to express your opinion accordingly, whether it is a qualified or a clean report, depending on the circumstances you do the audit. Yeah, hope I am clear in this. So, why do we need auditing standards? We need auditing standards because we need some kind of a guidance for expressing our opinion on the financial statement. And because we are professionals, we need certain broad guidelines to, you know, execute our work. So, and if you do it within that framework, our opinion will be unbiased. So, auditing standards are required to form a basis of opinion. Also, as per the Companies Act, we state that it is required to be stated that we follow all the auditing standards issued by the ICAI under Section 143(10). Our responsibility primarily is under those standards described that under audit responsibility paragraph for the audit of consolidated financial statements or standalone financial statements, whether it would be a corporate entity or non-corporate. So we have, I mean, as I said again and earlier and now, there is an explicit statement which we are making in the audit report stating we are performing the audit as per the auditing standards issued by the ICAI. So we need to understand what are all the auditing standards applicable to us and how we do the audit. Okay, so let's go and refresh our memory in terms of audit. Audit can be corporate, non-corporate, doesn't make much difference, because these following four steps are there in any of the assignments, even if it is a corporate assignment or a non-corporate. Probably, you know, where there are no less complex entities or smaller entities, the time you spend will be lesser, but these four steps are essential.
Sir, Vijay sir, one of the member called me. They are experiencing a little breakage in voice, sir, due to some problem in microphone or something. Okay. It is not that much clearly audible.
Is it?
Please, yes. Some disturbance is coming.
There is huge rain outside.
Okay.
I am speaking very loudly also.
Okay, sir. Sorry, I wanted to pass on the message.
No, thank you. But there's a heavy rain outside. That is also one of the impediment for me.
Okay.
I am speaking from the top of my voice only.
Okay, sir. It's okay. Okay.
And could be a connectivity issue due to rain also. Anyway, we need to face it. Is it okay now?
Okay, sir. It's better.
And it again depends on, you know, the bandwidth of the people who are sitting on the other side too. Okay. Anyway, I mean, you can you can stop me, you know, when you have hearing difficulty in, you know, in my presentation, because these technical glitches, we can stop and again restart, you know, if required. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So as I am saying, you know, we need to refresh our memory or knowledge in terms of these four steps on any of the assurance or an audit engagement. And I tell you, okay, this presentation we will upload in the branch's website, so it may be helpful for you to relook at it. Okay, I mean, let me start with the first speech, that is acceptance and continuance, which means when a new client comes to your office, we cannot just like that take him on board because he could be a bad apple. He can spoil the reputation of us, and you know, we may face trouble if we associate with that kind of a person. So what do we do? There, SQC 1 talks about certain procedures which you need to perform. Like, you know, banks and others, they have KYC. Similar to that, we need to have our own KYC in terms of clients when you are taking him on board, when you are accepting them with you. Even this can be helpful for you, even for your tax filing also, because these days even the tax filings are being tracked by IP numbers. So if that client or that person gives all the forged data and it is going through your IP address, you may face litigations because of the connectivity exists in these times. So acceptance and continuance. Continuance is for the existing clients. These two things are very important whenever client walks into your offices. Whether this particular process is important even for small or large clients. And in this process, once you accept a particular client for any of the assurance engagement, you not only for the appointment letter you ask them to issue, you should also have an engagement letter in place for that specific client. Why engagement letter? There is a clear standard, SA210, which talks about what are all included in an engagement letter, which This will save you, because once you issue this letter on your letterhead and get an acknowledgement from the client, which includes, you know, what is the scope of the audit and what is your responsibility and what is the client responsibility, and whether the client is going to indemnify you in case of any mischief played by him. All these clauses will be there in that engagement letter. So, my dear professional colleagues, please don't think that it is only a mere piece of paper, but by getting your engagement letter signed by the client along after you receive an acceptance letter, that means you are making him, or you are binding your client, that he is aware of what is his responsibilities and how he has to indemnify you in case of any eventuality. So Institute, I think, is coming up with an implementation guide on this issue of engagement letter also, which will come in due course. We are in the WASB. It's still in the discussion stage. But nevertheless, if you go through the standard and read, and standard has already had certain illustrative guidelines on engagement letter. And if anyone wants a draft engagement letter copy, kindly write to your chairman and he can ask me so I can share that with all of you. And kindly use that as a first starting point of defense for all of you. And this engagement letter is not only for corporate clients, this will also helpful for non-corporate clients, including your tax audits and the certifications. I hope I'm clear on this acceptance and continuance. And you should, okay, there are guidelines, you know, if you are appointed, I mean, generally for small and medium entities, it will be an appointment at every year. So you have to have in your file at the first state is your appointment letter must plus your engagement letter, which you issue to the client and ask that senior guy, or I mean, suppose if it is a partnership firm, the senior partner who is responsible for the business, he has to sign and, you know, revert back to you saying we accept the terms of the engagement. This is must and mandatory for all the assurance engagements, including the certifications. Certification is also an assurance engagement. If you look at the statement of peer review, it includes audit, statutory audit, internal audit, certification, GST audit. Of course, now GST audit is no longer there. Any other assurance function where you are, you know, putting your sign, I mean, where the UDIN is required, for all those engagements, you need to have an appointment letter and you need to have a, you need to have a engagement letter. Okay. So next, once that process is done, then the next stage is planning that particular engagement. So there are, I mean, I've just given you an illustrative standards of 300, 315, 320 and all. We'll come to know what it is. Like, you know, first you need to understand that business and assess the risk of risk associated with that business and what could go wrong in each of the financial statements of that particular entity. So this is not only for large entities, mind you, even for small entities also. Risk means what can go wrong. What can go wrong can be for large, can be for small, can be for medium also. So don't think it is only the risk of material misstatement is applicable to only large entities. We don't have you any financial statement, because the materiality differs from the enterprise to enterprise, the company to company, or the firm to firm, the size. So the risk of misstatement, the what can go wrong in these financial statement, the what is material in the large entities may not, I mean, what is not material in the large entities may be material in small entities. Suppose if an entity with 10 lakhs net worth, 1 lakh misstatement will be material. Misstatement on account of fraud or an error. If there is an error of 1 lakh in a 10 lakh net worth company, it is material. Or even for that matter, 50,000 rupees for a 10 lakh net worth company is also material. Similarly, for a large entity, it may not be material because, you know, their net worth could be 100 crores or 200 crores or 2000 crores. Their materiality will be computed in a different manner. I'll show you that template, which is already, you know, there in the institute domain on how to compute a materiality. I'm saying it, I think Rajendra Prasad Garu, there was a question on where can we get the formats. Yes, I'll share it with you. Kindly bear, don't jump the gun. We are there and we will definitely share you those formats. It is there in the institute resource pane, but nevertheless, for your benefit, we will share it. Okay. And so while if you are planning a particular assurance engagement properly with what can go wrong and what procedures you need to perform for those things that can go wrong, which you estimate that this may go wrong, and you know, you get a sufficient and appropriate evidence, and what test has to be done at what time, if you can plan that, which staff has to be employed, are these staff are as competent enough to understand that particular business? Business is business, whether it is small or big. You need to understand the business. So the standard on understanding of business doesn't restrict only for large. Even for small also, you need to understand. You need to understand the entrepreneur's psychology and how he operates. Then only you can estimate what can go wrong in the financial statement. Then you execute, like, you know, what is while executing, obtaining confirmations, so on and so forth. Finally, you have to issue a report. And if it is a corporate, I mean, SA 700 for corporate clients, they have given, even SA 700 gives an illustrative example even for the non-corporate clients for a report format. So kindly understand these four steps are very, very important. That's why I'm spending little more time in this particular slide. And these standards, which I have illustratively identified, which are all the standards which are applicable, which needs to be read, are all here. These are all only illustrative. Then, you know, you need to, there are other standards because of non-availability of space. I have not mapped all the standards. Okay. So let us now understand these auditing standards, how they have been categorized. There is SQC1, the series is 0 to 199, but there is no 99 standards available. Please don't worry about it. SQC is only one standard which talks about statement on quality on audit, and it talks about the quality, which I will touch down on the quality matters in the subsequent slides. And there are introductory matters. The series is 100 to 199. And general principles and responsibility, which includes your engagement letter, then auditor's responsibility, things like that, which is 200 to 299 series. But, you know, if you go to the standards, you will definitely know what the categorization of the standard and risks and risk assessment and responses to the risk assessed, which is 300 to 499. That is the series which they have given. Audit evidence, how to obtain an audit evidence, what kind of documentation to be placed is between 500 to 599. And when you are using the work of others, I think this may not be that applicable, that much applicable to small and medium entities, except in case of, you know, doing relying on actuarial valuation, or if the payroll is outsourced to some other entity, or if there is an internal audit and you are relying on the internal auditors, then these standards are applicable. What needs to be done, and kind of then conclusion and reporting, which is 700 plus. So this is how the structure of auditing standards is all about. Let us look at the primary focus is on, you know, in terms of, you know, the quality within the firm and the responsibility of leadership. This is for all the firms, irrespective whether small, big, kind of, because the there is no difference between a small firm and big firm when it comes to quality of audit. Maybe maybe in case of a small firm, the size of the client will be small, but the work you have to do is the same as a large firm. But while performing that work, the time spent may be little lesser than what you spend for the large firm. So if you look at the responsibility of the leadership of the firm, it is every individual with adequate experience and background and capability and authority should own up the role in the firm. So ownership of whatever the work you do is cast on the leader of the firm. So he should say, I mean, he should drive the firm resources. He should drive the culture of quality in the firm. It's not, the people in the firm should not think Chalta attitude. They should understand each of the auditing standards when they are performing the work, what they do, or the tasks which have been allocated to them, whether they are doing in line with the auditing and the applicable accounting standards of that particular task. For example, if somebody is verifying inventory, let us assume. So this AS2 is applicable. So AS2 says the inventory should be valued cost or market value, whichever is lower. So is to say what kind of components of cost should be included. So, and when it comes to the documentation, you have to, I mean, the team who is doing that verification of inventory should have a proper validation steps. And instead of just answering yes, no, they should also, you know, give supportings why yes, and what documents or information which they have verified that has given that leads to a conclusion that it is yes, or it leads to a conclusion to a no. So all these things should be there as per the documentation standard. And leaders should walk and talk. These days, even in the news channels also, you will see programs relating to walk and talk. So the senior partners should have a continuous interaction with their team members. They should carry the team along with them. They should spend more time with the team in terms of ensuring the engagement, the engagements, whether it is for the small client or large clients, is going as per plan and as per the standards laid down by ICAI. You should have a system, clear, consistent, and regular in communicating the quality, importance of quality. And staff and team should be adequately trained to ensure the assignments are executed with high quality work. And they should also be see how the staff will, how do you drive the staff? One of the means is, you know, if they compensate well. I hope, you know, our members are these days compensating their article students or the other audit assistants, compensating well, but we may not be matching with the other large firm standards. Okay, but nevertheless, that has been, most of the firms may consider this aspect, otherwise retention is a problem for all of us. Leadership should recognize that quality should not override the commercial strategy. So because he is paying peanuts, or if he is a free client, because of whatever the relationship you have, you cannot do a hodgepodge work. You should have to have the same quality, same amount of compliances, what you do for a paid client and for also non-paid client or less paid clients. Because the moment you put in pen and the paper and sign these financial statements, you are ultimately responsible. If you don't have enough evidence to support your conclusion, then you have to face the music. Commercial considerations do not override the quality of work performed. This is very, very important for all people in the firm. And friends, I am telling you, this quality control review mechanism is not only for small clients, even not only for large clients, even for small clients also, it is very, very important. For example, as I said, client acceptance procedures, all like banks and other institutions seek for a KYC, we should also have such kind of procedures in our firms. And we should, when you are putting your staff or when you are going with going on some assignments on board, you have to give declarations with respect to independence, because we are saying we are independent. How do we say we are independent? There should be a mechanism to prove that we are independent. What is that mechanism? There will be, the mechanism is called independent declarations obtained by the firm. So there is a specific format for independent declarations. Probably, at the end of the session or little later, I can show you, I can share with your branches the independent declaration form. And it is not merely a sign-off document. You need to ensure, suppose you are sending it to a client A, and the boy whom you are sending is related to that client A partner. He cannot just like that sign that independent declaration and get away. as a partner, you need to ensure that because he is related, he is not independent to engage with him. So you should not be put on that particular client. He should, like, you know, you get the director's declaration under 164(2), like, you know, expression of interest, things like that. So the similar process we need to adopt on with respect to all our staff members and partners also when it comes to matter of independence. Then significant risk of material misstatements due to fraud and errors. You should have identify a risk response summary. That means risk is nothing but what can go wrong in either an aggregate transactions or an individual transaction, which you all know, because you are dealing with the same client day in and day out. You know very well. Only thing is you need to translate that things can go wrong in a piece of paper. And also you should have a planned program whether that risk, whether you can mitigate by your auditing procedures. If you are unable to mitigate that risk, you have to necessarily take that in the audit reports stating a qualified opinion. And reports on financial statements, your working paper on critical matters. That means, you know, you find any issue, you should have a critical issue documentation in your file. This is also, you know, you feel laughable, you know, when I talk about small clients, what this thing. No, even small clients also, it is essential. Suppose you find a particular issue, later on, you could come across by any means that, you know, this issue can be mitigated. You need to document and, you know, give a background of that particular issue and the basis of your what you're supporting with respect to that issue and what are all the accounts that have been affected by that issue and what is the conclusion that you have reached, who has prepared this issue document and who has reviewed, and if it has to be agreed by other partner, get his concurrent signature and document this in your file. It need not necessarily be a paper file. It can be even in Word or whatever it is. The only thing is you need to agree all these things, stick your signature and dates in that and file it in a specific client file, whether it is a soft copy or a hard copy, doesn't matter. So the working papers for accounts of transactions identified prone to risk of material misstatement due to fraud and error, you should have it in your file. That's what I'm saying. You know, when you prepare a risk of material misstatement, then in that particular, like you say, you have debtor balances, you have an issue, like, you know, you will not get confirmation. So what you have plan to do, you will do an invoice-wise verification for the balances outstanding at the end of the year. That is called an alternate procedures. And you should also see whether these balances are subsequently received or not. All these things needs to be documented in your file. Yes, let the debtor balance, let us say 1 lakh, which comprises of 50 balances. Okay, so list of all those 50 balances. Next to that 50 balances, yes, we have seen these 50 balances. Each debtor, I have verified with invoice number, so-and-so, against each balance. And I have received, subsequent to the year end and the date of signing, out of this 50, the 1 lakh, I have received 80,000 against individual balances. So these balances are good and recovered. For the items which you have not received, you have obtained them. You comment from the management or the persons who are in charge for collectability that the likely date of those collections. Document all the things in the file. I'm telling you, it need not necessarily be a paper file. It could be on a soft, you know, Excel, Word, or whatever you use. Put that, stick a date, time, who has prepared it, to whom you have talked about, and, you know, who has reviewed those papers. These are all very, very important, friends. Consultation process. It could be internal consultation or an external consultation. All this consultation work should be in a manner, it should be documented in the file. But of course, you have consulted and got an opinion from the third party. but the responsibility lies with the partner of the firm who is signing that financial statement. This particular thing is not only for large entities, it is also equally applicable for small entities. Only thing is, you think that the documentation work has been increased. No, it was there. We have diluted it of late, and we got confused with respect to soft and hard copies. In my old days, way back in 87, 88 and all, where we used to have hard files, each client file used to consist of almost 300 to 400 pages, 400 documents in a file kept, I'm talking about the manual file. When I have done it, probably you also can do it. Only thing is, you need to, spend more time. Probably we need to educate our juniors and others in terms of how we can, how this can be implemented and things like that. So I don't want to bore you much. So I want to, share with you. There is a practitioner's guide for audit of small entities, which is there in ICA. Okay, anyway, I will share it with your branches after the program is, after we complete this program. This is a very useful guide, which has been revised till 2020, where it talks about the model working papers that can be there for small entities, small audit working papers. Let me try to share this with you. Let me see. Give me a minute. This is a practitioner guide, which I want to share. I hope you're seeing this. It is visible, right?
It is visible, sir. Visible.
Okay. So, okay. Let me go with the first format. See, look at here. The index of this document is model working paper, as I said, on board, what kind of documents that are required to see the profile and information about the auditee. You have the applicability checklist, you have engagement letter format, you have acceptance and formalities checklist. And I'm a matter of caution to all of you is, just filling up a checklist with yes, no answer doesn't save your responsibility. It doesn't shelve your responsibility. For each of the yes answer or no answer, there should be a supporting documentation in your file. Okay, let me tell you what I'm talking about. Let's say, okay, this is a model working paper for small audit, right? Generally. So you need to have a client name, what the year in which it is, who has prepared it, his date, who has reviewed it, and date. So first, as I said, this is the index for your file, right? Letter of appointment. So your letter of appointment would be for that specific year from the client which you received. It could be in the manual file. If it is there in the manual file, you have to say manual file folder number. So you have to create different folders, or if you are obtaining it in the soft copy, create a folder, give that folder address in the working paper file. Let us say, okay, a client A Limited folder, in C drive and folder acceptance in that, you know, the file is letter of appointment for the year 2021. You can write it in the working paper file reference, right? And if it is a manual file, you have a manual index, say manual file, you write folder number acceptance and continuance in the manual file appointment letter and page number. You have to number that, let's say 1. You can write that. I hope I am clear. Then communication with the previous auditor. So if you have obtained a mail from the previous auditor, copy that mail in a soft copy folder and give that folder reference against this working paper file, in the working paper file, this thing. So that if any of the peer reviewer or regulator comes, you can just show him, this is the folder which I have. Or if you have obtained a manual letter from the previous auditor, you can show him the file which you maintain, the manual file for that particular year with specific dividers saying appointment and acceptance letter, one folder and so on and so forth. Then he can just browse with the, letter of appointment 1 if you write, communication previous auditor will be 2 in that folder. So each of the paper or this thing has to be numbered. That's what you see in the peer review documentation also. There's a standard question being asked whether the working papers are serially numbered. When we ask for vouchers to have a serial number, why can't we have serial numbers for the working papers we collect? Please ask that kind of a question to yourself. Then profile of the client. I mean, I'll show you that. What kind of details that you need to collect when it comes to the profile of the client. Right? Let me go down and show you. This is a very, very important. See, this is what the institute has. This is only a suggested format, friends. There you can modify, do whatever you want in terms of this, right? Name of the auditee. How do you get the name of the auditee? Could be some kind of a legal regulatory document. Like, you know, if there is a GST registration, you put that GST registration, say that, refer GST registration. Folder, if it is, you have obtained a soft copy, give that folder reference, the working paper number of that particular and put it here. The year of audit, you can write what, based on the appointment letter received, this for the so-and-so year. The period will be determined. Okay, it is a duplication, but still you can. Then the constitution, you can, I need not mention. So if you say it is partnership, you should obtain the partnership deed or whatever the document you obtain. And if it is a private limited company or public limited company, you should have an incorporation certificate that could be given in the permanent audit file earlier. Give that particular reference and the working paper and number that in the file. Numbering is also equally important. Then, well, each year, if it is a regular client, you need to say whether there is any change in the constitution of the firm. So if it is a partnership firm where you are going to do the audit, obtain a declaration from the partners that there are no changes to the constitution of the firm. And in case of limited companies, constitution, if there is no change to the memorandum of association or the articles of association, you can find the changes in the while reviewing your board meeting minutes, or if you go to the respective, you go to the MCA portal, find out the documents what they have filed during the year, and accordingly obtain that particular copy and stick it in your file, and then give a cross reference to that. And see, nature of the work, all these things you can mention here. Address of place of business, you can have it here, which will be in line with what you have done for, what you have got from the legal regulatory document or the incorporation certificate or the partnership deed, whatever it is. You should say obtain, don't leave it there. Cross-reference to what document you have verified, from where the address of the place of business you have obtained. That should be documented. That is what is called a complete documentation. I hope I am clear. Kindly raise the issue if you have any doubts in this document itself, because it is very, very important. We are talking about the KYC of the client, where we need to have all these things in our file. Look at this. Phone numbers, email addresses. Why we need the phone numbers of place of business and all? Because sometimes we send the bill. When we need to follow up, the phone number what we may have might have been disconnected or whatever it is, so our bill will not be collectible. That is the first thing. Okay, the client dodges the payment, they think us we are worse than their vendors. That's a different issue. But we need to have a knack of collecting the fees, for which at least we need to have his phone numbers, contact numbers, email IDs, everything should be there in our file. Income tax PAN. And I tell you, friends, you know, the big firms, what they do is they even collect the passport copies of the directors also in their file. You know why? If they have traveled to tax havens like Luxembourg and all those things. So there, you know, they calculate what could be the risk of these guys having a relationship with the shady transaction. So to ensure, to mitigate that risk, they collect passport copies of the directors also. So all these things, you need to collect and keep it, whether it is big or small. Now you tell me what I have told you, is it sensible or is it not? I mean, even for this method of accounting and all these things also, don't say cash or mercantile. What is, where you have seen that it is cash, or where you have seen it is mercantile? So that needs to be documented here. Then this needs to be, you have to get all these things signed by your client and his designation. Then you should also revalidate what he has given to you. If something is missing, you need to collect and keep it, cross-referencing it and put it in your file. How is it? It is all been given by the institute. I have not manufactured everything. So this is what it is. Okay. Then applicability checklist. This particular guide will help all the entity, all of us, you know, when we follow all these things. There are umpteen number of formats. Let me also share with you in terms of engagement letter. Look at this. He has given you responsibility of auditors, responsibility of the financial framework. This is not only for large entities, it is for small entities also. Then other relevant information about your fees and blah, blah, blah and all. You can also insert indemnity clause here. You can also insert the management responsibilities. See, here you have management. So the moment you make, you get it signed by them, after you sign and then send it to them, they know, yeah, what is their responsibility. And in case of any litigation, you can use this as your first line of defense. See, look, you have already signed a letter agreement with us. You said you are going to, you have said you will indemnify us. This is your responsibility. You agreed on that day. So obviously, you are responsible for any kind of nasty act which you have committed, or any kind of fraud which you have committed, which has not been, we are not able to find out from the audit procedures which we perform. Okay. I hope this is helpful. Then the other important, I will say, is the acceptance format checklist. This has to be prepared by your senior person and then reviewed by the partner. Look at this. Is it a new engagement or the existing engagement? Simply ticking yes or no is not suffice. You should have an evidence to say, okay, let's say, is it a new engagement? You will say no, right? Because it is a continuous engagement. You should have a supporting document for saying no. What it is, we are already, there should be a working paper where, you know, it says, we have already been an auditor of this particular client in the previous year. The auditors could be your being a tax auditor, who mean you are the auditor of that particular firm for whatever. If it is a private limited company, you have already been appointed in the previous year. So you can say, refer our previous year file for the appointment letter, which we have already had that reference file in your documentation, which will help you. So this is the appointment letter format. Yes, refer so-and-so in whatever the file. Okay, you say yes, and then attach your working paper to this. You say yes, tick here, and then refer so-and-so, so-and-so. You can write under that yes. Communication to the previous auditor, other letters to the company. ADT1, if it is a non-corporate client, ADT1 may not be applicable. Have you issued a standard engagement letter? Yes. If it, acknowledgement obtained? Yes. Then this particular conclusions on accepting, if you have received any newspaper cuttings or any other information about that client or director, he has not confiscated anything, which have documents available from public domain. You can write all those things and give your conclusions accordingly and say, we are accepting this particular client because we feel that there is no risk to the firm. That is very, very important. Okay. Next is your representation letters. Another very, very important thing, you know, if you look at your peer review or other things, we are not capturing the time what we spent on each of the engagement. This is also essential. So there is a format which Institute has given, illustrative format only. You can tweak this and this is a robust documentation. Why? Because it says budgeted hours, rate, you can define what is the rate. There is a, for you, where do you find the benchmark for your rate? Institute has given a minimum recommended fees. Because this is very important. In the peer review, there is a question being asked whether you have followed a minimum recommended fee guidelines issued by ICAI. If you have all these things in the place, you can show this to your client, then this will also help you to increase your audit fees. You can say, okay, look, I'm spending so much of time, this is the fees. So obviously you need to compensate. You have a very good negotiations when it comes to your tax department and other regulatories. So the same can be applied to your client also. And I am not for people who says it is very difficult to increase the fees or not. If you show this kind of a document to the client, he will definitely pursue value addition in the work what you're doing. Okay, you're spending so much of time. He will think twice, yes, to increase your fees. Merely going with him saying, okay, I want fees increase, probably he may not agree to that request. But if you show this, definitely he'll jump and he will accept your request. Okay. So, there is another documentation which is again important. You all think, how do I document about the accounting process? There's a format given by the Institute. You read, you can write all these things, and this document will help you in terms of understanding the client accounting system. From this, you can prepare your risk response summary. Then they have given you an audit program. So there are checklists and programs available. My only worry is if you if you just fill yes, no, like, you know, schedule reference without giving any reference to whatever you have done, you just say performed by and some date, it is not going to save you. You will still face more litigation by not ensuring the support for whatever the answers you are giving in this checklist. People are forgetting. They are just thinking by saying, using a checklist, say yes, and then, yeah, I have a checklist, I filled up. No. What is the evidence which make you to say that yes answer is missing? That is what NEPRA and other regulators are asking these days. So please ensure that these things are there in your file for whatever the answers you give for your the checklist. Like, see, analytical review here, and there is also a materiality template. This particular guide, I'm telling you, if you look at this assessment of risk, what I was talking about, risk response summary, it will also talk about what assertions that are affected. I don't know how many of you are familiar with account balance assertions. That means, I will just refresh your memory. The institute, if you are saying a fixed assets of 1 lakh, let's say, for example, that means in the balance sheet, that means fixed assets of 1 lakh is complete. That means all the transactions related to fixed assets are recorded only once and only once. There is no duplication. Existing 1 lakh, you are saying. So the fixed assets worth of 1 lakh exists. That is another existence is an assertion. Then the fixed assets 1 lakh amount represents it has been valued correctly based on the invoices and available. That means it has valued correctly and it shows only 1 lakh. So all these assertions, the presentation disclosure, okay, if it is a corporate client, it has been disclosed as per the Schedule 3 of the Companies Act, which is applicable for private limited company and also small public limited companies. So there is no difference. So completeness, accuracy, validation, all these assertions, this is how you need to look at it. And see here what kind of audit procedures you perform for each of the accounting balance, which is also there. We can have a detailed audit session separately in terms of, you know, how do we drive. Look at this. I was talking about the materiality template. We always talk about financial statements materially misstated. He has given you, the institute has given for small entities only, not large entities. How do we compute materiality? And there is a detailed guidelines. If you can spend time in with this booklet, you will do an excellent audit. Only thing is, the stumbling block is first year, you have to, if you start implementing this, you need to spend little more time. Subsequent years also onwards, it will be a cakewalk for you. And like how the larger audit firms, then this will become a repository for you. All these days, we are just cribbing that institute is not helping in terms of our knowledge aggregation, which is wrong. I mean, I'm not saying institute definitely had a lot of documents, knowledge repositories in its place. Only thing is, it is not properly advocated to the educated the members where are there, how to use it. This is the missing link. Now at least, by virtue of these kind of meetings, without wasting much of the time on the introduction and other aspects, we are able to educate all of our professional friends in terms of how do we do an effective and efficient audit and the documentation to save our skin. Because the moment you put your signature on any of the financial statement, your neck is on the chopping block. That's what I say. Whether you agree it or not, this is how it is. So friends, I mean, like that, if I have to spend time, you know, it will take a hell a lot of time. You know, kindly go through this particular practitioner guide to audit of small entities. I think I've spent a little longer time. I made you bored. I'll take a few minutes break for your questions. Then we will switch on to Udin. And now, as I promised, I hope I have concentrated only on small entities, not look, but nevertheless, what is applicable, what are all the things that are applicable to large entities are also equally applicable to small entities. And kindly share this knowledge to all your friends and tell them, don't think, you know, gone those days that, you know, the probability of we getting caught is remote. The probability of we getting caught is very high now because the information is well knitted and connected. Anybody can ask any question for whatever you are doing. If you don't have enough evidence or enough documentation to support your work, you are caught. You have been going on the wrong side of the thing and you will be challenged. Challenged in sense, as a traffic cop, you will face the music. Okay. So let me take some questions here. I'll stop here. Then we'll go back with Udin in the later part.
Already, some of the questions have been posted by Ungol branch chairman, sir.
Please
the chat box.
Please read it for me. If,
yes. Engagement letter is required only for attest assignments or all assignments. This is one of his queries.
Yeah. Can I answer that?
Yes,
sir. I feel it is required for all the engagements. Why? Because you are going, I mean, if you receive an appointment to perform a particular procedure or a audit or non-audit, you should know what is your responsibility. You should also educate the client what are all his responsibilities. And you should also have some kind of indemnities in place in case if that particular client is not sharing the correct information to you. Be it a test function or even for that matter, you are doing a tax filing for that matter. If he shares wrong information and you file wrong tax things, you know there is a specific section which has been introduced now. I mean, I am not that expert in taxation, but 271D or whatever, there is a penalty section which says any person. The moment you file, client will say, sir, I don't know, my auditor have done it. And you know the penalty as per that section. It is on the transaction value. So where do we go? If you don't have an indemnity clause binded by the client for his mischief. So I feel there should be an engagement letter for all. And in that engagement letter, we all should have an indemnity clause which says that he has to indemnify us in case of any kind of indecent work or even incorrect information he furnishes and wherein which we have been penalized at the later stage. I hope I'm clear.
Yeah, we agree and concur with your view, sir. Mm-hmm. But the issue is, where are the resources?
What?
We in our daily practice, we used to have some 30 to 40 assignments on different kinds. Starting from GST registration, GST filings, or 15 CACB, like that, so many works we are doing, all are small and miscellaneous works. Are these proprietary concerns, are all these SMEs are in a position to draft a well, legally vetted engagement letters? Why we are in backseat?
I think, you know, the practice has been diluted of late and we have become a little lazy. See, if you are going to face the music from the regulator, you still keep yourself open and then invite him the trouble. So there is a template already there, which I've shown you in the guide. What you need to do is, you need to insert an extra clause in terms of indemnity. If my memory goes correct, I have already shared an indemnity clause with when the bank audits were being done in that bank audit engagement. probably, you know, even I have written as a co-opted member to the institute that while giving that guidance on SA 210 on engagement letter, I proposed a draft indemnity clause that, you know, you can add and then insert it any, because we are very good in copy paste. So that indemnity clause can be inserted in any of the engagement letter. See, I'm telling you, first time it will be difficult. Subsequent years, it will be a process on its own. And don't take a pretext or, you know, an excuse. You know, if you look at no empathizing your actions on what you are doing in previously is correct. No, because you are being faced in a different manner and we have diluted our processes. Because I have done it when I, in the 89-90, all these things in the manual, when there was a manual error. When I can do it, why it, see, there also at that time, it used to be the same amount of work, 50, 60, 100 clients. But even that time also, we used to have the entire file in place, then only it should go to a partner for his signature. Whether it is a small certificate or a large certificate. What are the minimum documentation that is required? It should be there in the file. Otherwise, the partner used to throw the file on our face. Because he knows at that all the old people, they were, you know, they know the risk what they are carrying. But off late, we have diluted. We thought that since the probability of we getting caught is remote, so we can do whatever we want. Kindly don't get, I mean, don't show empathy for what you are doing. Don't give lame excuse. I'm very sorry for my blunt words. Please don't give lame excuses for the work what you have done. Be it small or big, you have a bigger responsibility. Okay, if you give that, you know, I am not able to do whatever it is. Who is going to save you when some, I mean, regulator comes and sits in your office?
My question is, see, we are all agree with those are very, very important and they're definitely going to save our scheme. But now the issue is availability of resources for a small practitioner who is a proprietary concern, whether it can draft all these kinds of engagements by just seeing an audit engagement letter. See, the institute has published one model audit engagement letter. It will not suffice for the other assignments. Why can't we have
Mr. Rajendra Prasad Garu, let me submit one thing. We know how to, I mean, are we not good in drafting legal letters? How much time it takes if you have a format and tweak your own words? I don't think, you know, as an expert, which you have so much of experience to redraft that. It may not take, only thing is you should have will or conscience to do it. If we take those kind of excuses, it will go on and on and on. See, earlier we said the institute has not supported with any kind of document. When the institute has come up with some guidance, we said, where is the resource? Why not? See, it is not difficult, because when I can do it, you guys can do it much better and more than what I can do it. That's what I'm saying. Please don't give any kind of lame excuses, because you are the front end and you are going to face the music. And if you still feel, have guts saying that nobody will catch me, I still go in my own way, like how Rajinikanth says, that is up to them. I'm not going to support. I mean, I strongly advocate when there is a benchmark, we need to be above that benchmark.
We need to educate our staff, sir, who will be handling the
staff. Yeah, that's what, sir, if you put this
in our office, we are having a standard set of documents which captures major issues or whatever. We have a major template, and for all the assignments, we used to take the template.
Yeah, this guide, which I've shared with you, is a big helping in helping for all the small and it has been designed for small and medium practitioners only.
No,
let's take some of
us. What you shared is, I think, published some 12 to 13 years back. Still, I am having the original version of the copy, even hard copy also. we encourage all our members to adopt all these things.
It is not only encouraging, sir. They have to. They have to. Period. Next question, please.
Next question.
Sorry, when it comes to regulatory compliances, I am very strict.
No, I want the emphasis from your side. That is the reason why I have raised the query.
Thank you.
Are already following so many compliances from our side, but for the clarity to the other members, that too, particularly for the proprietary concerns and juniors, I have raised this issue.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So I think sir has covered all the questions, sir, in chat box. Rajendra Prasad, sir, anything else you want to ask?
To you,
sir. Whatever you have, okay, to Udin, right? Sir, then we can proceed to Udin, sir.
Okay.
We have purchased one publisher, Pramod Jain. He is having a lot of checklists and all the practice assignments in that book.
Sir, I suggest, please follow this institute template, which has been revised in 2020. And if you follow that, there is nothing like that. Okay. So I mean,
yeah.
Okay, there are publishers. I don't deny. We need to respect our own institute resource, what they have, because people like us spent a lot of time in designing and issuing. I mean, thankless job, I'll say, unpaid job, because you cannot. For this knowledge repository, I mean, nobody is being paid. You know, it is all done to educate our fellow professionals. We want to see the institute flag fly high. Okay, so let's. If you are all, are not having any other questions, let me go through the other topic called UDIN. And you all know UDIN is an 18-digit system-generated number. Which is being needs to be generated for all certified and attested documents by a practicing chartered accountant. And just bear with me. Yeah. So this is the UDIN website. You all know. Let me navigate the UDIN website. So we all know it is an 18-digit number. The object of the UDIN is to curb the malpractices by the non-CAs. That was the basic objective through which this UDIN has been introduced. And this will also enable the regulators, banks, and third parties to check the authenticity of certificates which we issue, reports, and other documents. While saying this, it's a double-edged sword used against all the practicing chartered accountants. Because everything has become black and blue. And the regulator or the income tax fellow can catch us if, he can compare the number of UDINs generated with your source of income. Okay, you may have a lame excuse saying I am not billed. Nevertheless, he will come back and say, okay, there is a minimum recommendatory fees given by the institute. So why are you not charging that? That means you're suppressing the income. So we will charge you on the deemed income also. So that please bear that in mind, because there the taxation guys may take that kind of a position for all the UDINs that you generate. Okay. And this is just to refresh your memory in terms of how this 18-digit is all about. First 2 digits is relating to the year. Next 6 digits is relating to your membership number. and next 10 digit is a randomly generated number, right? So it is, there is no fees, it's free. So UDIN is secured. It is all available in your specific UDIN login, and regulator can see it. You can download this UDIN summary in an Excel or whatever, and during the time of peer review, you can submit this along with the other documentation checklist. And when you need to generate UDIN, you have a 15 days window period, and you cannot, see, it says it's been, you know, within 15 days, you need to generate UDIN. There could be a lot of questions. What if and all, we'll take that at a little late stage. No documentation is required to be uploaded for generation of UDIN. Fair enough, but you have to keep copy of the documentation which you have signed, where you have sticked on to your UDIN number on that. What I have seen off late is the UDIN number is generated, and people are putting the UDIN number only on the copies which you issue to the client, but they are not retaining their office copies with the UDIN numbers. That is separate and this is separate. And last minute, they do hodgepodge. If you have a proper procedure in the office where, you know, generate two copies, one is your copy and the other one is client copy, or take a photocopy of what you give it to the client, probably this confusion can be avoided. Then when it comes to the applicability, you all know. It is mandatory for all the certified true and fair and true and correct documents which you issue. And concurrent or, so these are all the things for which UDIN documentation is essential. There are around 36 things which the institute has given. You can find it in your in the UDIN portal. If you still have any doubts, I'm happy to clarify that. Then what is not covered, which is also very important.
Sir, nothing is visible on the screen, sir, just showing it is has started. Nothing is visible, sir.
Sir, I am able to see the screen, sir. So some problem at your end. I am able to see the UDIN.
Sir, website. Even I am able to see, sir.
Okay, great. Great.
Good.
No issues. So what is not covered?
Sir, while generating UDIN, if you select the wrong category, is there any issue?
Wrong category in the sense?
In case of audit report, we had mistakenly selected it as a certificate. Is there any issue?
Yes, definitely there will be an issue. Immediately you need to cancel that and regenerate. That's what I say, because that number is unique for that particular item which you have asked.
Okay.
And if it is not that, because that number you stick on to that financial statements or whatever, and you are going to issue to an external agency. If the external agency is going to verify that, and what you have stated and what you have stated here is wrong, then definitely that will become an invalid thing.
I think, when external agency verified it, it will just give the number and it will throw out the figures which we had given in the certificate or whatever figures we had mentioned there.
No, he will have an access to what you are signing.
Yes, the figures and everything is same, but inadvertently wrongly selected the type of the certificate or audit report or something else. While selecting, maybe it's a concurrent audit, they have selected it as a certificate. I'm just asking a hypothetical question.
No, hypothetical question only I'm asking. If you are giving a UDIN to a wrong thing, it is the duty cost on you to cancel it and then regenerate it.
Okay.
That's it. So only CAs in full-time practice can only generate UDIN. Certified true copies, UDIN is not required. UDIN has to be generated by the signing partner only. Firm cannot register in the UDIN portal. It is the individual's responsibility. So UDIN has to be generated for manual as well as for the digitally signed documents. I think most of the people have questions with respect to this. The institute has clearly clarified saying online certificates like MCI, MCA, ROC, RBI certificate reports, UDIN has to be generated and retained for providing the same on being asked by any third party or authority. So if you are issuing a duplicate certificate, you need not take a new UDIN. The same old UDIN is applicable, but you need to mention it very clearly, saying that, you know, it's a duplicate copy. Like how, you know, banks or other institutions, when they give a duplicate copy, they mention it. So we are also supposed to mention that. So UDIN is mandatory for all the certificates from 1st February, I think 2019, you all know. A part-time COP holder cannot certify any documents. Kindly note that, very important. I mean, how to register and all, let me skip these questions. This question is very important. Whenever you have multiple reports, like there in the bank audits, whether a separate UDIN is generated for all the reports, the institute says no. So for bank audits, you can generate one UDIN, and then, you know, the same UDIN number can be used for all the bank documents, wherever you are signing, either by manually or using your DSC. Another question, we don't have a cap on the number of units, UDINs generated. However, I have already said, the number of UDINs generated will be a double-edged sword. The regulator, whether it is ICAI or the tax guys, can, you know, compare the income declared with the number of UDINs generated. Okay. I mean, this will also give, I'll say, it's an opportunity for us. You can showcase to your clients, look, for this document, I have generated UDIN. So you have to necessarily, this is the fees for that. Even lawyers and others can, you know, make the hay, why can't we? Kindly think that it's an opportunity. So we can, I mean, and it will, we can say that, you know, free work can be eliminated. So wherever this kind of a certificates or whatever is there, we can bill their client, things like that. So one, if you generate one UDIN, you cannot use for all the documents issued under that assignment. So, and there is a specific, this particular answer, I think, sir, is applicable to the question what you have asked. If I generate a wrong UDIN, what do you do? Instead of certificate to the report, report to the secretary. Kindly cancel and issue the same. That's why, you know, there should be a maker checker check while doing that. And I won't take that excuse saying we don't have a time to do this kind of a checks and balance. It is our signature, it is our reputation on the chopping block. Kindly do a checking before you generate a new deal. If you, if you're giving to somebody else to do it, and that is incorrect. That's why, you know, they said the signing partner of the guy has to generate the UDIN, and you cannot delegate that work to your juniors. If the junior has a bad, this thing on you, he can play on your life. So please ensure that at least the UDINs are generated by you, not relying on your juniors, which I think the majority of people are doing it. Kindly, I request them to refrain delegating this work to the juniors. How much time it will take you for, we are so big and experienced, fair enough, but this is our responsibility. So I request all of you, you know, to generate your own UDINs rather than delegating it to somebody else so that the other can make a mistake and they cannot take shelter saying, sir, I don't know, I have generated this and all that stuff. Now, I mean, questions can be taken because we are reaching closer to our closing time. I'm happy to take questions.
So, members, whether any question regarding UDIN, please shoot the
question. We have just 5 minutes, that's it. I thought I'll be finished faster, but it has taken a little longer.
It's okay, sir. Even though more than 5 minutes, it is fine. People can come up with their question.
Yeah.
Anything regarding UDIN, members, whether you have any doubt for a particular document, whether UDIN is required or not, you can ask the question and get it clarified.
So I think, you know, if they don't have any questions, they can you can compile, Sujit Kumarji, all your questions which have been raised subsequently and shoot it to me in the mail. I'm happy to answer at the later stage.
It's okay, sir. Yes.
Because I've seen members are very shy, you know, in asking in the public domain. Probably, you know, they want to shoot the questions at a later stage, you know. We are happy to answer. Because anything for the members, yes, I'm there.
Thank you, sir.
Because we are all on the same page and we need to be protected to the extent possible. And whatever the mudslinging that has been going on, it is because of our negligence and our carelessness. So we need to try to scare and then, you know, make them aware of the regulations, rules, things like that. So at least we will maintain our dignity in the profession. And
basically, it is about yes, sir. Survival is important now.
Not only survival, you know. See, we are almost having a power of a quasi-judicial member. See, our report is something like an FIR or even a judgment copy. We are failing to understand, you know. We think, you know, because the client is paying peanuts, whatever he asks, we can sign, and then, you know, he can get away. Make us liable for his acts and deeds, which is incorrect. We are not using our powers.
Yes, sir. That is that there is a great power cast on us, and the great responsibility is there. Mm-hmm. And since it is not being properly delivered, the profession, these powers can be taken away. That's what I am saying. We need to survive. That is what I meant by the survival. Because otherwise, if you don't do it diligently, these powers will be taken away, and then the profession's glory will go away. So people need to be very aware, as you said, alert, and need to do this all these procedures first. Okay. So I think we can move on to the closure of session. Arun?
Sujitji, one small thing, I think.
Yes, sir.
There is one question on, please throw some light on time availability, resources, manpower capabilities, fees, and more important, risk if it is not maintained, not following the standards. If you are not following the standards and say that I follow the standards, if you have been caught by the regulator, that's it. You have to face the music.
To give more emphasis for these matters, once this filing period is over, we are planning to have a training, peer review training for all our members. So once this December is over, then we are going to concentrate on these kind of aspects. We are already having plans. We already discussed with the Nellore branch chairman also. So that more people are aware about the peer review process, then they will know the importance of documentation, and they will be more well-versed with all the technical guides and all.
అది కాదండి రాజన్ కుమార్ గారు, ఎవరు వస్తారని వాళ్ళకి భయపడి మనం చేసే దానికన్నా మనము అని దట్ వి షుడ్ షో అవర్ చెస్ట్ దట్ 56-inch చెస్ట్ వాట్ ప్రైమ్ మినిస్టర్ ఇస్ సేయింగ్ సో వీ హ్యావ్ టు బి ఎక్విప్డ్ విత్ ఆల్ దీస్ థింగ్స్ అండ్ సే కమ్ సీ క్యాచ్ మీ ఇఫ్ యూ క్యాన్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ వీఆర్ ఆల్ ప్రొఫెషనల్స్ అండ్ వీ నీడ్ టు గో విత్ దట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఎ మెంటాలిటీ రాదర్ దాన్ యూనో గెటింగ్ స్కేర్డ్ సంబడీ ఈస్ గోయింగ్ టు కమ్ అండ్ సీ అస్ సో వీ నీడ్ టు డూ we need to change that kind of a mindset.
No, the peer review will give a complete oversight about the standards part.
Agreed, sir. If you follow the process, what has been given for small and medium practitioners, all those templates and all, how to use it and what needs to be done. If four or five firms come together and, you know, at least, see, I mean, sorry to say, unless there is a pinch of some financial liability and all these firms to do, people for freebies, they don't bother. Okay, it is available free. Why should I look at it? And let me see afterwards. If you say this is chargeable, like, you know, GST and all seminars, even if you put 1,000, 2,000, they'll come and attend. Whereas this is so important, they are not bothered. I'm not saying about the branch. I appreciate people who are very patiently listening to what I'm saying. But you know, if four or five firms come together, and then if we can develop some kind of a file, how it looks like, and train everyone. It is not only for articles, even for the members and the signing partners, it is equally important. Tomorrow, they will not get caught. Only the senior guy will be caught. So kindly bear that in mind. Gone those times where we can, okay, if people have influence and they can get away, I'm not bothered about this 1 or 2%. I'm bothered about the rest, and that 1 or 2% of bad apples will have a larger influence on our total members. So we don't want to get associated with that, you know, like how people fought in the parliament saying, you have done it 5 years back, when I do it, why are you complaining? So we are not of that kind of a mentality. We are professionals.
Agreed, sir. Agreed. Well said, sir.
Sujit, yes, sir. One of our senior member has requested that if UDIN was, if a person forgot to generate a UDIN and the 15 days time period has also expired, so what's the remedy in that case, sir? It was the question posted by our senior member, sir. So kindly give a light in this regard, sir.
I don't think there is a remedy if you forget after 15 days. Kindly write to the UDIN help desk about this. I don't know if you woke up after 2 months or 3 months, I don't know what reply they give. There could be some kind of a condemnation if that is the case. Or, I mean, don't take it. It's my personal opinion. If it is delayed by 1 or 2 days, you can change the date and generate the UDIN. In the remarks column, you can say, I mean, this cannot be a regular feature. It could be a one-off thing. and don't quote me anywhere. This is my personal thing. If it is opinion, if it is 1 or 2 days, okay, yes, then you can write it in your remarks while generating the UDIN itself. I have forgotten this, so I am changing the date instead of this date to that date. There's a remark column row available, right? You can write there and generate the UDIN. This could be one of, they can see
one
that
of the way.
One of the way, but it is not the official way. You have to communicate this to the UDIN help desk, and whatever the answer you get, you follow accordingly. There is no second thought about it.
So, any other questions?
Sujit, one more question.
Okay.
So, the attestation activity for these individual returns and all, the bankers were asking for individuals to sign, give whether we had to give UDIN or not when we are signing or attesting the individual returns, which are not tax audit cases.
So what is that attestation means? Are you giving a certified true copy or
yes, just true and correct copy? Certified true copy, sir.
Why should you give in the first place if it is generated through an IT portal? Banker. You need to educate the banker. I don't advise. See, you have not validated any of the client information, right?
Sir, that case was actually filed by me. I am even giving a mail stating that the user ID password of my client is so-and-so, so that you can check it in the portal. Even then they were insisting.
No. Why should you say that, sir, in the first place? If they want this thing, there is a SSAE 4400, there is a report, specific report format. You, yes, along with that, you with the IT return, you issue that report, probably that will suffice.
Okay, sir.
There, you know, if you do that, you need to generate a UDIN also for that. But yeah. I personally feel we should not be in the business of issuing true copies of information filed by the client, especially on the income tax returns, because although we are the auditors for financial statements only, we cannot audit their computation of income. There is no way we can guarantee the computation of income is true and correct, right?
Yes.
The client can give his own certified copy. And nowadays, if you see your income tax return, if it is e-verified, the details are there, no? Even those details are forged, we don't know. The moment you e-verify the return and file it, all the details are captured in that acknowledgement copy, right? And if you generate the written copy, there is a water logo of income tax, a water logo on the back of that particular paper.
Yes.
All that what we need to do is we need to educate the banker.
In the last week, when I am interacting with one of the senior member, they have advised that we are not supposed to sign on the certified true copies. That
yes,
is the
he is
conclusion
right.
They gave to me.
He is right. That's why I'm saying we need to educate the banker, because you have to tell him very clearly, look, there is a water logo of income tax. Even that cannot be forged, right? Client can sign it as a certified true copy, or ask that banker to come to the client office, let him generate in his presence. Ask them to send some of their staff members. That's an alternate procedure. And don't generate in your office.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Right.
Okay. So I request our past chairman, CAI Vamsi Krishna, to propose vote of thanks and proceed to closure of the CP meeting.
Thank you, Sujit. First of all, I would like to thank our today's faculty, sir, for his excellent coverage on today's topic, standards of auditing and UDIN. And I also personally thank Chinnamassan Garu for his efforts in bringing this today's program into force. And I also thank all my support staff of both the branches for helping us for conducting this program. And from my heart, I personally thank all the participants who were there in today's program. And if you are having any doubts, as Vijay Kumar sir said, your doubts can be jot down and mailed to us, so that we can
personally mail it to sir and get the feedbacks. And I also like to remind our members that the portal for MEF has already been started. So I request you to please go through the portal once. And if you are having any practical doubts relating those aspects, let us sort it out at the early stage so that the FAG and the last 1 or 2 days, instead of struggling with a few questions, it would be better it is get it solved before itself. I thank the Nellore branch and the Ongole branch managing committees for giving me this opportunity. Good night.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for patient listening. And excuse me if I'm a little harsh on you guys, but that's where we should, that's why where we should be to see that the profession flag flies high. Thank you. Good night.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Namaste.